probably a lot of people know me more by the fact I worked on loads of Beatles sessions and did a few technical things which are remembered by some people. But I don't think many people know about how the Beatles actually came to be here at Abbey Road on the 6th of June 1962. It's a long and winding road to a certain degree, but at that time, every town and village virtually had a pop band. And most of them were fairly good, but you know, it was very hard to get a record contract because at EMI, we had Cliff Ridge in the Shadows. And the general impression was that if you got somebody on a pop group on your label, you didn't need a second one because your marketing budget and your sales budget wouldn't cover the cost of having one group competing against another. And anyway, the Beatles had been for an artist test on January the 1st, 1962 at Decca, just up the road. Now, Decca were our main rivals, really, in those days. They'd started in 1929 up here in West Hampstead, and but they were been up there, and they were rather ridiculed by Bill Rowe and two of the Shadows, Tony Meehan and Jet Harris, had moved up there, and Tony Meehan was an A&R man. Anyway, they were rejected out of hand by Decca. And they say, or Brian Epstein say, they'd already tried to get a record contract with the EMI, but nobody was interested. And well, the next part of the story was that Brian Epstein took a tape down to the HMV studios in Oxford Street, and he wanted a disc cut. And the strange thing was that we at Abbey Road used to go down there occasionally with Arthur Pook. We used to check out their disc cutting equipment because it was situated on the mezzanine floor of the Oxford Street store. Anyway, he went in there and he cut a disc from his tape, and the engineer there was Jim Foy, and He asked Jim whether what he thought of it. It was, I think it's quite good, he said. And he said, well, what do you know, what any idea what I could do? He said, well, there's a in the floor above there's a music publishing company called Beechwood and Ardmore and Beechwood. He said, and there's a chap called Sid Coleman up there. I can take it up to him and see what he thinks. So he rang Sid Coleman and he told him that, yeah, pop up and see me and I'll have a listen. And he went up there and he said, yeah, that's all right. He said, have you tried EMI? He said, well, I've tried. This was to Brian Epstein. I've tried EMI, he said, but there's nobody particularly interested. He said, have you tried George Martin? I mean, he's done quite a few things recently and got some success with quite a few records. And he said, no, I haven't tried him. So they phoned George and spoke to his secretary, who was Judy Lockhart Smith, now Judy Martin, then became Judy Martin. And she arranged for him to come up and see George. And that's how George organised an artist test here at Abbey Road on the 6th of June 1962. Right, having told you how George got the lumbered to a certain degree, possibly was the word, to have a commercial test for this group called the Beatles. He arranged it to happen on the 6th of June 1962, which actually was the anniversary of D-Day, which was a day that a lot of people wanted to celebrate the landing on D-Day. Anyway, I was scheduled. I came up on the weekend before because we were doing. I'd worked on Beyond the Fringe with George, and on some of the sessions I did with George were Beyond the Fringe in the Cambridge Art Theatre, all the Fortune Theatres of Drop of a Hat, Drop of Another Hat, the Establishment Club. I've been up to George with Scottish dance bands, Jimmy Shand, Ian Powery, Lindsay Ross, Jim McLeod, and been down at the Saints Jazz Band in Scotland. And so I was, George Stewart and myself were like a little team to a certain degree that got on well together. And if I couldn't do them, Keith thought it always did. So George had arranged this session on the 6th of June 1962, or provisionally did. And on the Friday before, the weekly programme was being published, and penciled in was commercial tests for George Martin on the Wednesday. It's a long and tall story, this, I'm afraid. Anyway, at that stage, Jim Hellis walked into the amp room and said, "Bloody hell," he said, they only want the bloody artist test now in the evening. And we were working so bloody hard, we were working night after night. The sessions were building up at an unbelievable rate, morning, noon and night. And to get a commercial test done in the evening, and Gus Cook had asked everybody except me whether they could do it. And they'd all said no. Anyway, on the Sunday, I'd been up in the morning and I'd set up the Beyond the Fringe audience one for here, because with audience it's a bit more complicated. But I wasn't staying at the session because I was playing cricket against a team called the Gayfarers. And when I got home that evening, there's a phone call from George Martin. First time I've ever had a phone call from George, I think, at home. And he explained that he's got this group coming up from Liverpool on the Wednesday, and Stuart can't do it, because Stuart couldn't do it, I don't know, but Stuart had been doing the art test. I think Stuart had probably got some other commitment that night, and he couldn't. He said, "I've got Norman Smith to do it. Now I'd like one of my team on it if possible," he said. "Could you please come up and work on the session?" And I said, "Okay, George, yeah." Now, I didn't really want to, because I was due to go to Rome about 2 weeks later for 6 weeks to record Cavalier Rusticana and André Chenier, two operas, and I was going to be away from home about 6 weeks. So on the 6th of June 1962, I was here in Abbey Road, and I'd agreed to work on this session. And but before that, I'd come up on the Monday, and Gus Cook was my boss, and I was called down to the office, and he said, "Ken," he said, "I gather you've agreed to work on this artist test on Wednesday night for Martin, George Martin." I said, "Yes, I have." Now, he didn't like anybody going for the back door to get you. So he says, "Okay." Didn't sound too happy about it anyway. That's by the by. Forget that. And on the 6th of June, the session was scheduled to be originally 7 to 10, but I think it was changed till 7 to 9 actually. And Norman Smith came in to see me in the amp room, and he'd got his session sheet laid out, which he'd written out. And he was checking with me about the microphone positions, because I'd worked on loads and loads and loads of Cliffridge and the Shadow sessions. And what Norman did was fine, actually. Anyway, I came, we got a phone call. I was here in the afternoon, and it was only, we got a phone call saying, could they start an hour early? Now, fortunately, that was possible, because the control room was in use, but the studio wasn't. So I managed to set up the studio before, and then once this was clear, I lined up all the tape machines and put tones on the tape, etc. And Norman then came in, and I checked everything out. And that time, I was sat exactly where you're sitting, basically, and Norman was stood in the window, and I was just finishing up putting these, doing the final checkovers on the tape machine with the azimuth and etc. And Norman looked out the window and said, "What the heck have you got here?" Looked down, there's these four young lads walking through, all looking identical. And so Norman and I walked down to the studio, and I put out the distribution boards and chatted to them. And I was immediately taken back by their sense of humour and the way they were, and the fact they all look the same. They're like four clones. When they arrived, I went downstairs with Norman Smith and spoke to them, and I was quite knocked out by the way they were, and their sense of humour, in particular their Scouser accent. And I got on quite well with them, actually, and we set up their equipment, and George Martin then arrived upstairs here, and we started recording, and I think it was Bessie Me Mucho, the first one we did. And there was this terrible sound from the bass guitar. It was a rasping, you can describe it really as a farting sound, really. And we tried several things to cure that. Norman Smith lowered the level downstairs and raised it up here to no effect. And so George basically said, "Look, unless we can do something about it, we'll have to abandon this session. We can't put on tape this dreadful noise." So they retired to, they went to the canteen and had some tea, while myself and I think Norman was with me, but I had this idea about getting the loudspeaker out of echo chamber one, which is a big tannoy speaker, and getting a TL-12 amplifier I had upstairs on my desk, which was going to take to Rome with me. And I fixed up this in the thing and sorted out the what sort of jack socket was required, and tried it all. And when they came back, lo and behold, it actually worked, which was incredible, really. So we carried on working. So I often think of that's, sometimes I think that's what I was brought on this earth to do. But could never have done it if it had been a daytime session, because the management would have bloody killed me if I knew what I was doing. So that was the start of my involvement with the Beatles. And at the end of the session, I was quite knocked out by them. In fact, not their musical, but them as people. And funny thing was, I went off to Rome to record Cavalier Rusticana with Francis Dunant and Victor Olof. And I kept thinking about, I wonder if the Beatles have been back to do a recording yet. But strangely, they didn't come back until just after I got back. But on Cavalier Rusticana, we had a terrible trouble. It was all going very great to the very last day, when Franco Corelli, who was the tenor, and Victoria Los Angeles are supposed to do their duet. And Frankie's wife came in, and his wife was his manager, and she says, "My Frankie, you know a sing today. He got a butter throat. He's very sore throat. He know a sing." So how are we going to do a duet on the very last day? And so Victor Orlov said to me, he said, "Kenny," says, "you've worked on a lot of pop sessions. Anything we can do about this?" I said, "Yes, quite simple, really." I said, "Look, just what we need to do is just lay the orchestra down today, and we'll overdub it back in London. And will that work?" He said. I said, "Yeah, well, of course it will." I said, "You know, we do it for pop sessions all the time, so you know." So when I came back, from Rome probably in middle August, had a couple of weeks holiday and came back here, and the Beatles had booked in for September the 4th to do their first session. And I was involved in number one, because we're going to do the superimposition of Franco Corelli and Victoria Los Angeles onto tape. And I think it was the first overdub ever done for a classical recording. Anyway, the Beatles had come back, and they did some rehearsals in the afternoon in number three, and then they recorded here in number two. And they did Love Me Do, How Do You Do It, and a couple more, I think, Ask Me Why. And but before that, Ron Richards came in to see me and said, "Oh, Ken, any chance we could do, they've still got the same equipment, can we put this, what you did before. But I wasn't on the session, but John Fay, I think, was. And he found another speaker, and we used the same leak amplifier and the lead I made to use that on that session. But funny enough, although Love Me Do was made as the single, I took about a week later, the master, which was going to be How'd You Do It. I don't think many people know this, actually. I took it down to the factory, and then they decided not to use How'd You Do It, but to use Love Me Do. And they came back on, well, by the way, on September 4th, there was a new drummer, Ringo. Pete Best was no longer with them. Never quite found out why. I've asked Judy Martin, I asked George, and they all very quietly deny any knowledge of having any involvement with why Pete Best was not made the drummer anymore. And Ringo came. It looks a little bit different than the others. So on September 11th, we did another one in number two, when we had a session drummer in place of Ringo, and Ringo played tambourine. But that was the start of it. That was the start of the Beatles. And it was released in October, and I think it went to number 17 in the charts, which wasn't great. And so at that time, they were not big artists at all. And George was only recording them on mono, in fact, two-track mono, which is quite unusual, actually. And Cliff Richard was working on four-track, and it was ages before we got onto four-track. In fact, the first four-track session was the one I Hold Your Hand, which we took to Paris to overdub in their French studios, the German version of I Want to Hold Your Hand. So that was my first introduction to Beatles, and after that I worked on lots and lots and lots of their sessions, actually, in a technical capacity. The technical people, of course, are never get much credit. One thing that always amuses me is that every studio, to be good, requires good technical backup support. And the strength of Abbey Road has always been the technical backup. From day one, it's what's kept Abbey Road at the top of the tree, is the technical support and the facilities we offer and the standard of the equipment. And I'm not a fan of F1 racing, seeing cars whiz around in circles, but with the one that's the best starting off on the grid first, which seems stupid. But Lewis Hamilton, whenever he wins, he always thanks his backroom staff. And the funny thing about recording is a lot of people will say, I did this, I recorded this, I did that. And it's not I, it's we. It's we as a team do most of these things. And that's why I'm sort of sometimes a bit annoyed about the lack of credit that people get for some of the things they do, and others try to cream it all off. Anyway, that's just my little bit of agony, if I want a better word.